Welcome to Praxis, I'm Jess Scully. I'd like to welcome our audience here in Sydney, those watching on APAC, and those listening on radio or watching online, and those watching at the offices in Honiara, Dili and Port Moresby, and Jakarta as well, all those listening in from Canberra. Today we're discussing the issue of early childhood education. For this, we're joined by Dr. Sally Brinkman, who is the co-director of the Fraser Mustard Centre at the Telethon Institute for Child Health Research. We're also joined by Raelyn Lolohea Esau from the Ministry of Education and Training in Tonga. We're joined by Myrna Machuca-Sierra, who's the Education Specialist at the World Bank, and by Mary-Ruth Mendel. Mary's the co-founder of the Australian Literacy and Numeracy Foundation. Welcome to you all. The United Nations Millennium Development Goals prioritise access to education, and many developing countries like Tonga actually have made huge strides towards universal primary education, with around 90% of children globally having access to primary education, which is much more than ever before. However, in education, quality is what matters. Worryingly, the UN has found that after 4 years of primary education, as many as 250 million children still don't know how to read or write. And we also know that many children will drop out of school because of a lack of an ability to engage with the content and really succeed and thrive within a schooling context. Experts believe that a lack of school readiness is actually the problem. That's what's making it difficult for kids to benefit from their education. And those critical preschool years are actually the foundation for their later success in schooling and in life. Up to 57% of young children in developing countries have no access to preschool. And children living in the poorest households are up to 10 times less likely to attend early childhood education programs than those living in the richest households. So, today is about solutions. What are we going to do to help children from all backgrounds get access to this critical head start? And how does the family and the community play a role in giving their children an advantage? So first off, Sally, what do we mean by early childhood education?
I would start with early child development. So early child development is really, when we're thinking about how a child develops, it's not just about language and cognitive development. So we're also talking about things like social competence, emotional skills, emotional regulation, emotional maturity, physical health and well-being, as well as the more formal aspects of learning to read and write. So
There are five domains that you refer to in early childhood development. So education plays a role there, but what are those five domains that we use to kind of assess early childhood development?
Yeah, so we physical health and well-being, language and cognitive development, social competence, emotional maturity, and then what we call communication skills, and in some circumstances we call it general knowledge or approaches to learning, so things like perseverance and how you stick at a task.
What is the evidence that children who get support at that age, at that, because we're talking about from birth and pre-birth, as we've spoken about as well, from birth through to the ages of about eight, what's the evidence that support and real focus on that stage of development has a long-term impact?
There is a very large body of evidence, not only from developed countries, but increasingly from developing countries, about how early investment, especially from zero to, say, five, and in maternal health as well, actually paves the way for the trajectories that children are going to have later in life. It's a concept that is also known as skills beget skills, where the skills that you actually promote early in life, be it, as Sally was mentioning, perseverance, attitudes towards learning, approaches, motivation, etc., those will actually help you acquire later skills. It's also a concept that's known as complementarity. So if you actually have skills early in life, this will actually make other skills more productive. So if you actually lay a foundation on your reading skills and your cognitive skills and you're better prepared to tackle these concepts when you arrive in school, actually your learning will be more productive.
So there's a social element to that, to the development. Mm-hmm. There's a cognitive aspect to the development, but also there's a scientific basis for this. Mary-Ruth, with your background as a speech pathologist, from a scientific perspective, why are these years so crucial?
Well, like Sally's saying, there's the whole child, and what ALNF concerns itself with is, out of all of the skills that a child has to learn to go to school and participate in school, what is it that the child has to do to be literacy ready, to be able to go to school, sit on the chair and go, I get it, I know what the teacher's talking about, I can do this, and to have that really positive can-do experience. And we call that pre-literacy. In the academia, it turns up as pre-alphabet level. And pre-literacy is what happens at home or in playgroups or in preschools that prepares the child to be able to go to school and have that still developmental, still something where you've got to start on the building blocks and gradually build it up, because there is a brain science about it. It's not haphazard. It's something that we have to have as a focused play view of the child. But one of the things that happens in developing countries is that the families are not confident with their literacy. Maybe they speak another language and that's their home language, and then they know that the children have to go to school and it's going to be literacy in English. So ALNS concerned itself with not just what's the pre-literacy trajectory for that child, but how do we help the families know what to do with their children, build confidence, and most importantly, do it in their first language with a twin bridge to English. That's where we've been working.
We'll come back and talk about working in language and those tools and those skills. Myrna, in your research on school readiness, many developing countries have shown an increase in primary school enrollment, but there have also there's also evidence of serious challenges in reading comprehension. Can you tell us a bit about your research into that?
Well, the research that we've been fortunate enough to support in Pacific Island countries goes in line with what has been a global movement to start evaluating how well kids are learning to read by the end of grade 3 and 4. This is a critical grade in primary education because this is typically the break point where text becomes more complex and there's a greater demand for children in comprehending the content that is being delivered. And so this movement in testing whether children are actually learning to read for comprehension has now integrated more than 60 countries around the world, in Africa, Eastern Europe, and Latin America. And in the Pacific Islands, we have been assessing early grade reading, oral reading fluency and comprehension in Papua New Guinea, Tonga, and Vanuatu. And the results explain many of the learning outcomes that we see in later assessments. In Tonga alone, now 3 out of 10 children at the end of grade 3 were reading at a fluency that only allows them to comprehend 70% of more or more of the text. In Vanuatu, the figure is about 2 out of 10. So if you have most of the kids in a classroom that they are vocalizing what they're reading, that they are putting sounds to the words, but they're really not understanding the text that they're reading, once they move into a higher grade, they're not going to be really benefiting from their education. They will get discouraged, they tend to drop out, they will repeat. And so there's a lot of inefficiencies in the system, in the education system, if you're not really addressing decisions from the very beginning.
Raelyn, in the Tongan context, there's been great success in increasing enrolments, and education is really highly valued. Families support their children in getting to school. What are you hoping to see change in when we start to focus more on early childhood development?
In our strategic plan, we also like to join with the rest of the world by improving our literacy levels for children. But in 2009, thanks to the World Bank, they actually came to Tonga and we started, we had the Tonga early grade reading assessment. That was a wake-up call for us because we thought we were doing well. And we also tend to focus on primary school where we have a mid-primary test and a test where kids enter secondary school. So those were the only available assessment, points where we know what's wrong with how the kids are performing. Only when the Tonga early grade reading assessment was conducted that we realized that there is gaps to address with literacy. And then a few years on, then we had the Pacific early age reading assessment, which we had just started late last year. And we appreciate the fact that World Bank is coming to Tonga to work with us on this, because we realize that we are focusing first of all on the vernacular. That's a huge assessment for achievement for Tonga, because we're focusing on the Tongan mother tongue, the language, and we're going down to the early grades, which of course, for those who do not know, it's basically run by non-government organizations or private, private owners. So therefore, the Ministry of Education starts at class one in primary school. Therefore, we realize that this is a very important point in advancing education in Tonga. In Tonga, it's because we realize that we should start early. We should be engaging, the community, empowering the parents, and I think the most important thing is getting our teachers, our parents, the community engaged. And we have a lot of expectations, I should say, from the ministry and all of us that are aware of the work that's being done. So we would like to see at the end of the 3 years with this current program that we are going to implement or working on, we would like to see that there's an improvement in literacy. And I could see that there's already a lot of expectations whereby we would like to involve the community. There's going to be a lot of training. We're going to involve our teachers. There's ongoing education reforms to improve the teacher education, going down to teachers, preschool, in-service, pre-service, and it's going to engage the whole Tongan community. So we are actually very positive and excited about what's going to happen, and we would like to see results at the end of the first 3 years of this program.
Well, there's a bit of pressure for you there, Myrna.
A lot of pressure.
The bar has been set very high. Myrna, how will this program deliver support in communities on the ground in the field, because they're watching?
They're watching, and the pressure is on us, as you said. Well, the PEARL it stands for Pacific Early Age Readiness and Learning, and it has built on the work that we have been very honored to support countries in the Pacific, but also from the work that other donors are doing. And the evidence is there that there are serious gaps in learning, that there are also serious gaps in the access to these children to any kind of service or provision of early childhood development for them. And so our approach is actually at different levels. We want to support countries to improve the way they focus their policy and programs on these transitional years. It's not just early childhood education or it's not just primary. It's actually a transitional period in which you really need to support the kids to come better prepared to school, but also to have schools better prepared to receive these kids and teach them in a better way. We're now working primarily with Tonga and Papua New Guinea, but mostly with Tonga, but with all the countries in Vanuatu, Samoa, and Tuvalu, just to name a few. The idea is to help them increase the evidence base that they have and to assist them in produce a roadmap. What are the key things that you would like to achieve in a particular period of time so that you can get your gears going towards a very clearly defined outcome?
The roadmap, the research, this is all really crucial, and also this idea of training the trainers, I think, is really crucial. The work that the Australian Literacy and Numeracy Foundation does quite often is about supporting parents and supporting communities who themselves may not have a whole lot of confidence in their literacy skills. When you're trying to support those communities, what are some of the things that you do in the field?
Right, well, we work from a strong pedagogy around the brain science. But if we were to just concentrate on that, it's too overwhelming and it's actually too boring. So what we've done is we workshop and mentor the families, not just mums and dads, but all the grandparents, aunties, uncles, and who want to get involved, along with teachers, so that there's a whole of community coming around the children. And we workshop around early language and literacy, which is the brain science, but taken into bite-sized bits. It's actually an Australian accredited course, it's a certificate for, but that's its formal side. What we do is make it user-friendly, break it down into small bits, and then as communities start to participate, for example, if I was to say to Grandma, can you take the paper bag home and can you fill it up with as many things that start with P as you can find in your home and bring it back, and then we work with that. Just like, yes, you're doing pre-literacy. That's what it's about. You're doing it. And bit by bit, the confidence builds. Our experience is that family members aren't confident with the literacy, but are really great teachers with their children. So we put in the little steps to do, show them how all the bits build to the bigger picture, and we find that there's incredible uptake. Gaining confidence is remarkable. The dynamic around learning to read around the child changes from everybody's doing this whole sit back like, well, this is hard, we better leave it for teachers, into, no, this is a can-do thing. You know, I can participate in this and my child's actually getting it. So expectations around the child start to change and the child starts to think, oh, this isn't as scary as it all has been looking. And we start to have that stepping in, becoming part of wanting to know what's going on in that classroom. So all of our things in the before school are all about play and focus play. And as we step into school, we transition it into things that they would recognise in the classroom that they've been doing at home with their families.
And this level of engagement and these experiences are not trivial. I mean, for many parents, the activity of just sitting and reading with a kid is something that they do and they're pretty used to. But the research behind it shows that in reading with your kid, you're not only promoting literacy skills. There are obviously a set of literacy skills that you promote, but talking to your kid, the number of words that a child knows is directly correlated to the number of words that they're exposed. And so the more words that they read, the more words that they're in touch with, that's incredibly important. And there's a wide variation in it correlates strongly with socioeconomic status. And so if kids start lagging behind, even before they arrive to preschool or primary, because they have a very low or a very short number of words that they know, when they encounter words in primary school or in preschool, it's going to be very challenging, whether they know the vocabulary and they can connect it to knowledge, that's actually very useful. But at the same time, when the parents are reading with the kids, they're also promoting other activities. So say, for example, that you're reading about a story about a little animal or an engine, and the engine says, I think I can, I think I can, I think I can. You're actually teaching the kid perseverance and sticking to the course and doing something and really thinking positive that you can do a lot of things and not just dropping when things become difficult. So it's in creating this environment and promoting these experiences in the family, it's not just about the kid, it's about the parents and how you nurture that spirit in order to be better prepared when you come to school and in the future.
This isn't, though, just about extending school to start when kids are toddlers. I mean, this isn't really about bringing schooling forward. Sally, play continues to be so important, and what we're talking about here, I think, is about giving communities and parents some tools to offer some more structured play.
Yeah, the two main challenges for early childhood education and development are really the crossover between education and health and trying to get that link throughout. And health tends to focus on very much the 0 to 2, education very much focuses on the 5 and up once they're in school. And we know that middle age group is actually, in many circumstances, the most important age groups to be concentrating in. And there is a role for both health, education, community services, and every agency to work together around improving child development. One of the, as the knowledge and the science, well, the knowledge of the science grows around the importance of early childhood education, we are finding in some countries that there's this perception of, well, we just lower the grade that we start teaching children. So instead of teaching them at 5, we now start teaching them at 4. And, you know, the saddest experience sometimes you see is little 3 and 4-year-olds all sitting at desks and being talked to in what we call a didactic way. And that's not what we want. We want children to still be children. We want them to be able to play with each other and learn through play. And so the challenge for us is, how do we come up with play-based, easy activities that we can then role model and teach to parents and communities and community providers to be able to stimulate the child. So they're still playing, they're still doing everything that you would want a child to do, but you're actually providing some structure in that play. So you're actively stimulating that child. And so it's definitely not just about teaching a three-year-old. There's, in an education space, you're still teaching a child, but doing it in a very different way. And sometimes that's a little difficult to get across to when we start talking about early childhood education development.
A point that, the PEARL program in Tonga is going to be a pilot, so of course it will be responsive and it will develop on the ground. But one of the points that you're focusing on is the idea of village playgroups, and the idea, again, that crucial word of play coming into the picture, where it is about the village, it's about the community coming together to play and to be supported in play. Can you tell us a bit about how you might envisage that being sparked or stimulated?
Well, I'll start and then Myrna can help me out with some more details. But currently, I think we'll have to start off by training a lot of people. We'll have to train the schools to be prepared, the teachers. And when we go to the communities, we will have to inform them what we're planning to do. It will have to be structured in a way where the community are well informed. They need to know why we're doing this and how they can help make an impact on the initiative. Because when everyone, I'm sure every parent wants their child to succeed. Every parent wants their child to be able to go as far as university and succeed later in life. They just need to know why we need to see the figures. They would like to know that by doing this, it would help the child, it will help the role of the teacher later, and it will also help our children be more competent and confident. And later in life, we have a lot of other social issues that we are, you know, struggling with right now. And although we can't point to any, you know, figures or any data that's available there, but we somehow feel that perhaps we can make a change if we're going to involve the community, the parents, early in life in helping the children be ready for school, to be literate at an early age. I'm sure we will be able to spend less money on all these social problems that are emerging that we are also trying to fix as well. We also are trying to fix as well. And I've been involved in a number of things that we do not know if it's going to work or not. But I'm sure that PEARL, we have a lot of hope that by introducing all of this early, engaging the community to empower and enhance, you know, the knowledge and the support they can for the child, I'm sure the child will be a better child in the future and be productive for the society.
I suppose when we're looking at these, the context where we have less access to resources, there are two phenomenal assets that we often have access to. It's the parents there, it's the family, it's the community, and time, which I think is, a wonderful resource, which in many cases in more developed contexts is not as available. So there's that opportunity to take best advantage through a program like this, focusing on early childhood development and education. How does a program like this take advantage of those, poorer, less resource accessible contexts?
Well, one of the there are many strategies that you can put forward, and you really try to support children, get an environment where they're stimulated and where their skills are being developed. One of the strategies that we're foreseeing for Tonga, as Raelyn was mentioning, is the idea of the playgroups, and that the playgroups are facilitated by someone who has received the training, but it goes to the parents. So it's not just an activity where it's a weekly activity with the kids. The parents come with the kid and they drop the kid and then they leave. It's something that they need to work with the kid during the session, but at the same time, the parents are trained on how to do these activities, and they can do them at home. And they can work with kids if they have other kids of the same age range. They can also work with kids in this same range. Obviously, there is a learning curve for the parents. They may not feel confident enough at the beginning that they're doing it right, but it's a process. It's a point in where they are not left alone. It's a participatory approach. There are other messages that are passed on about nutrition. And in countries in the Pacific, it is incredibly important to extend this to as many kids as possible in as efficient and sustainable as possible. Whereas in developed countries, you see enrollment rates in preschool that are quite high. In the Pacific, we actually see pretty low numbers, somewhere in between 25% to 35%, depending on the country. So you do have still a lot of kids who are really unattended in terms of early childhood development, or largely unattended, that are coming to primary school not ready for the race, not being stimulated enough. And so these community workshops actually work really well in addressing that, increasing the face time with parents. Mm-hmm.
So we've already started to receive questions through from the field offices, and we'll come to those in a moment. But I wanted to talk about those tools. Just one last question on this point. Mary-Ruth, you have prepared through the ALNF the 7 steps to pre-literacy. It always helps to have kind of a path or a set of tools. Can you take us very quickly through what those 7 steps are?
Yes, in Aboriginal communities where they speak a first language in English, they're twin resources organised into what we call the 7 steps, and then sitting around books, quality books. So we have the resources around games, activities, because like Sally was saying, it's all about play, but focused play. We also have digital resources because, like Myrna was saying, families have got to get their feet with this. And like Raelyn was saying, it's going to take a while for people to get really on top of what they want to do with their children. So we've developed the resources onto iPad digital resources so that the quality instruction for the child is there, the accuracy is there, whilst everyone sits around that and works with it and develops their skills. So we very much support the families by training and statements of attainment and what they can do so they've got a career pathway as well and can use that to possibly get employment. We actually work by resourcing people so that they actually have in their hands sets of resources for these 7 steps. And not exactly tricky ones. It's like shells. So if you're going to do syllables, then you can put the shells out and you can play the game like, you know, crocodile and who can take the shell for croc and that type of thing. We also then have books, and we resource people with books, but also digital books. So the people record their own stories for the children. And it's a bit of bibliotherapy coming in because people get really enthusiastic about telling their own stories. And then we convert them into, like Mina was saying, reading around a book is actually really important for all that, the add-on benefits. So we've got 2 lots of resources. The actual tin tacks that go with the brain science of how to teach someone to, a little child to learn to read, when in fact your primary teachers are going to be literacy challenged and not very confident. And then secondly, we've got digital resources that take the pressure off that situation.
So we have received a few questions. I'm looking forward to hearing your questions here in the room too. This is a question from PNG. In PNG, a lot of parents wait until over the age of 7 years before sending their kids to become involved in education. What does the panel think the ideal age that parents should be sending their kids to school? I mean, we've been talking a lot about what you do to prepare kids for school.
There is a comment from one of our Indigenous grandmothers who said that preschool is our children's last chance at school. And she was reflecting on how important it is for children to get the underpinning building blocks before they go to school. So I think that's possibly, Port Moresby people, something that we've found important for the communities that we've worked with.
Age is certainly important, and you do, from Sally will know this better, there are certain ages in which children are developmentally readier to sit in a preschool setting, but it's not just about preschool. And in advising which age or what would be the best strategies, there is the research and the science for it, in which you do need to get some stimulation and services to these kids, but you also need to know that what's the capacity of the country to be able to to open this widely to as many kids as possible. So there are many, there's the policy side to it and how fast this can be extended to as many kids as possible, and it's also the type of service that you can do and a particular age where they can make the best, they can have the greatest impact.
It's a difficult question, I think, because if you start school too early, then we know from some research that you can actually have issues in terms of emotional attachment and emotional maturity. Mm-hmm. So you may be having some benefits from a language and cognitive and a social point of view, but you're potentially taking the child away from their family for too long, for too many hours. And there is some, you know, research to show that that maybe is not a good idea. There is some also research to show that if a child is not developmentally ready, we find this in more of the developed country scenario, that, you know, parents will often hold their child back from school. And many believe that that's a beneficial thing to do, that it's better to wait until the child is actually developmentally ready for school before putting them in too early and then not being able to actually cope with the environment that school provides, the challenges that school can provide. Coming at it from a more sort of societal and economic point of view, how the, I suppose, the governments provide school systems. I mean, the majority of countries now are really, you know, the school starts at five is a pretty standard and I think fairly well considered. If you're talking about brain science and the developmental aspects of a child, five seems about right. But again, you know, each child is slightly different and you do need to think about not just about whether the school is ready for the child, but whether the child is ready for the school.
Having said that though, people in Port Moresby, a lot of your children will be bi or trilingual children.
That's true.
And what we understand from the research is that pre-literacy, which are the building blocks for literacy, need to start in a child's home language. So that very first perception of listening to sounds in words needs to be about listening to their own speaking system and what sounds they're saying. And from there they build the concepts of, oh, there are words that are this big and the words are broken down into syllables and those syllables have got sound patterns to them, and they can start to experience the patterns, which is why the Pearl Project is a beautiful project, because with the families there and the mums and the families with the children, they can be doing those very first stages of sound awareness, phonemic awareness, if you like, with the oral language in the home language, and building all the capacity that we've been talking about with confidence and capacity around the child. And the interesting thing is you don't need any new assets. You don't need a teacher to come in. And you need the parents to hang with their children and use that quality time in a very focused play way. So I think there's like two parts to your answer. There's what can we do at home that is for the brain science and nourishes the brain to be a great beginner reader when they go to school. And that helps the child be a little bit more school ready, emotionally and as well as literacy ready too.
Now, we have got a question on this topic from the Solomon Islands, but I would like to see if we have a question in the room. Yes?
I'm Xiaohui Ho. So I have two questions. The first one is that we talk a lot about school readiness. I just want to clarify with the panel. When we see the school readiness, are we actually talking about, you know, some basic numeracy as well as the words in order for them to learn from what they're supposed to learn, like in kindergarten? So that's, or we are trying to actually build their capacities in one way or another. For example, they know how to discipline themselves. They not get too much frustrated when they actually have some difficulties. Those capacities, we call it as the readiness. So that's the two different definitions. The second is a more fun story, has because you have been talking iPad, and I can certainly tell like the difference between my daughter and my son, that my son used a lot more iPad for learning. So assuming that we have like lots of the resources for the Pacific Islands, so what would you think the most effective way? One is that giving the iPad to the poor families, loaded with all of those, you know, games, etc. And the second is that whether we should enable the communities to be able to use those readily available, like even the dirt, right? Like even the cooking tools, or even some papers, and to help them to actually use those readily tools to stimulate the brain of their children. So that's my two questions.
Okay, so we've got two questions there, one on low-tech versus high-tech tools. But the first question there was, I think, Sally, if you could take that one.
Most people would conceptualise school readiness as holistic. So it's definitely not just reading and writing and being able to count. It's being able to, being able to know how to go to the toilet before you get into school, and some of those really basic sort of physical things, knowing how to dress yourself, things like being able to hold a pencil, so some fine motor skills, right? So you really need those fine and gross motor skills as well as those social skills. So you don't, ideally you want to be able to have a child that comes into the school environment and is going to feel comfortable about making new friends and, is not really scared about that situation. So if you're just concentrating on the language and cognitive, you're not really getting at the concept of school readiness. School readiness is far more holistic than that.
It's about discipline, it's about socialisation, it's about being able to engage with others, respond to, yeah, to people on an emotional level as well, as knowing, as literacy and numeracy. Now the second question was a great question about technology and whether it's more effective, I think, to use high-tech tools like iPads, or whether it's just as effective to use the cooking implements or rocks or stones or whatever's available in an environment. Would you like to comment on that, Myrna?
I would say it's an issue of context and where and how ready the communities are to make the most of the medium to relate to the concept that you're working with. So, for example, we see that many preschool teachers and ACE, early childhood care givers, they could use very low-tech resources, pebbles, and they color them. And so, for example, we know that at sorting things by shape and colors, that actually develops a lot of numeracy skills in children. And this could be very, very low tech skills. And high-tech solutions are coming more and more because of how much information and interaction you can actually pack in one single device, and that's beautiful. However, you do make certain assumptions about the effectiveness of it. For example, you do need electricity to charge it. And in many of the communities in the Pacific, you don't have electricity sources, or reliable electricity sources. So you may have an iPad or a tablet, but if there are only an hour in which you can charge it, it's going to be rather difficult. Or if there's some sort of anxiety about technology, we see that many people, they're becoming more comfortable with text messaging and phones, but certain devices, so people react to certain devices in a different way. So it really depends on the context and how useful that tool is going to be to actually convey and develop the skill and the concept that you're trying to address.
We have a question from Ambrose Malafosi, who is from the Ministry of Education in the Solomon Islands. This is directed at Mary Ruth, but also at the panel. This is about, as we know, PNG is one of the most linguistically diverse contexts in the world, and Solomon Islands too. What are some effective strategies to improve reading in a country with many diverse first languages?
It's a great question. We have developed a course where we can teach community members and work with community members so that we can take the language, the oral language, and distill it into the type of literacy language features you need to then create your own resources. So the seven steps that we call to pre-literacy, there's about 15 games for each step, so that in your own language that becomes a set of games at each step. In addition to that, the sounds for phonemic awareness is all templated as well, so we can drop the features, your language features, into those templates and very quickly create them. The people who are very best at the oral language are the first language speakers. They don't really need any help with that. What they need is the literacy resource production assistance, and of course that's what we do. And then we've templated it so that we can replicate it very easily and cost effectively through many communities. And the great thing is that it's in digital version. So if we make a mistake, it's not that we've printed up 50 copies of something, we just can change it. And lots of community discussion happens around the development of these resources. But what happens is that in the hands of parents and teachers are some really quality paper resources, low-tech ones, for focused play incidentally whilst you're with the child doing things like cooking. And also there's some really more high-tech and more pre-literacy, seriously focused on getting that child ready for school in the digital formats.
If I may add on to what Mary-Ruth has mentioned, starting with the mother tongue, as she was saying, it's the way to go. It's rather difficult in, say, countries like PNG or the Solomon Islands, where maybe the number of speakers is not enough to make it cost-effective to create specific resources in all of the different languages, or it could be very difficult in terms of the time and the burden to do it. But if you can't do it and you can favor the mother tongue, that is the way to go. We also have countries where there may be an oral structure to it, but there's not an alphabet, there's not a visual cue. So how can you teach someone to read if there's not a visual cue that they can decode? And or if the children speak seven languages, but the teacher just speaks one. So we see experiences from other countries in which we try to also advise countries to focus in a language that a child is familiar with. It may not be the mother tongue, it may not be a one or the second, it could be a Creole or a pigeonized version of it. But if the child is aware, it's familiar with that and it's proficient with the structure and knows how to communicate, then it becomes a vehicle that you can use in order to facilitate pre-literacy and literacy skills. There is a lot of work that needs to be done in order to not for the kid to lose its mother tongue and also to develop the basic structure and their oral skills in their own mother tongue. But there are different ways of going about in very challenging contexts like that when you cannot favor one or the other.
And sometimes in an area, there's going to be a lot of the language and the features of the language are the mm-hmm. same, and there's just variations depending on how people have been using mm-hmm. that. So we've just been making variations, and people say, well, in my area I would pronounce like this, and in this area I'd pronounce it like that. The thing is that children's listening and literacy learning skills are becoming highly enriched even by all those conversations as well. And there's a lot of buy-in at that level. It becomes a real community activity, which we sit in twin resources with English, so that bridge building is there. So, mm-hmm. so that because at the end of the day, the children need to develop oral awareness, sound awareness in their first language, their home language, but build the bridge in English because they've got to go to school and read, learn to read and write mm-hmm. In English at school.
So the summary is that focusing on the mother tongue is really crucial, mm-hmm. But then creating those opportunities for bridges to other languages and then to English in the Australian context here.
And some of those digital resources are now being resolved so that we're using solar regeneration, and we're using bigger screens so that groups of children can sit around mm-hmm. the screens, because when you get more children around a screen, they're going to do more talking and more problem solving. So we've been learning a lot in our projects on how to really get the most out of using the new technology.
Do we have another question from Sydney? Yes.
Hi, I'm Anna Partridge from the Wayside Chapel. The importance of early childhood development, this is probably for Sally, is in Australia is not new. I mean, play, building, resilience, parents, creating a love of learning has been around for many of years. But I know as a teacher myself, I talk to so many parents that say that schools for learning to read, to learning to write. Are we improving, or is it there's some sort of disconnect from generation to generation? What's your sort of take on that?
We actually are improving. So in Australia anyway, we have actually been able to monitor child development over the last nearly 10 years now. And we are actually seeing improvements on most aspects of development, but more so actually on language and cognitive development. And we haven't really put our finger on what it is as to why we've been seeing that improvement, but we believe that some of the federal government initiatives, like the minimum 15 hours access to preschool and the increase in quality requirements of preschool, so that it's not just about childcare, in terms of the childcare organisations, that the quality standards are not just about safety. For example, not just taking a child to a care arrangement, and we're concerned about safety, but now the regulations are starting to move towards, it's not just that provision of safety, but provision of stimulation and development, and that you're actually trying to do something with those children rather than just putting them into a centre-based care arrangement. And so those sorts of things, I think, are starting to filter through. So we are having an effect, but I do many community presentations across Australia, and it still, in a way, surprises me how many parents still think that they're really just getting their kids to be at a stage where they get to school and that's where they really learn, right? And they're not really learning in the home environment. And I think that's a shame. We always talk about parents as the first learners, the first teachers, that message maybe has a little bit more work to do to get out there more globally, yeah.
That's one of the things that's interesting and applicable in so many contexts, is that a lot of these projects are about participation. Mm-hmm. And they're about participation from community, from parents. Everyone is engaged in the process of learning and teaching, which is incredibly empowering, I think, for parents as well. We'd love to take another question from the audience. Oh, good, we've got plenty. Let's start up the back and work forward.
Liam Morgan from UTS. If I can just get Mary-Ruth to continue on with what you were saying before about the importance of home language. We've talked about children being school ready, but not so much about schools being child ready. Mm-hmm. And the role of schools in acknowledging the home language of children. What are your thoughts about that?
Well, on a policy level, there's been some challenges around that, but I think people are starting to understand that home language is really important, and early stages of pre-literacy and home language is critical. So everyone's moved to the next step of, how do we do that now? And particularly teachers are going, I only speak English, and it's quite often what happens in remote communities. So what we've found is that by going through the process that I was talking to the Honiara people, Port Moresby people about, of having the community working in first language and developing the resources, for example, our children's dictionary, which is a word bank that's, they can touch their words and they can hear one of their elders saying the words in syllables, so it's not just a dictionary, it's actually a pre-literacy learning to read resource. The teachers all grab those and they want to be able to. So there's no lack of enthusiasm from the teachers, we find. In fact, they're incredibly motivated. But the disconnect happens because often the teachers' assistants, who are first language speakers, don't have the confidence to speak up and teach the teachers, and the teachers can't access the first language in any really sophisticated way and don't want to be disrespectful to the language. So everyone in all their politeness means that it's like it's a no-go zone. So the resources in first language and in English, because they're always in both, means that everyone can come around those resources. The teachers then, and I tell you, I am one of the worst speakers of Anindilyakwa language. There's a lot of laughing when I try to pronounce those words. But the shift in the authority, the shift in who's empowered and who has the knowledge set, goes to the first language speakers. And who's the learner in those circumstances are the teachers. And once again, we find that the teachers are providing the teaching pedagogy of, how to teach reading. And the first language speakers are providing a lot of the resources and the skills in language. And it just breaks down those barriers so nicely. And it happens around the digital. There's no, because we have all first language speakers doing all of their pronunciation on the resources. So there's a lot of pride about that. And it means that they're in the position of teaching just from that one resource, even if they're feeling very shy that day or they're feeling particularly tired because they're very busy, the communities. The quality of that resource just fills that gap. So the elephant in the room is always that, and we can fill it with those resources.
We will come back. There has been another great question on mother tongue learning from PNG, but I'll just take another question in the room before we get there. Yes?
Hi, I'm Bonwyn Fraser from Uniting World, and my question's mainly to Raelyn and Myrna. In terms of Tonga, we work in partnership with the Free Wesleyan Church, and over the last couple of years, they have been implementing quality early childhood education across Tonga, very much in the way that it has been described here. With the Pearl Project, how is that going to engage with what is already happening on the ground? There is some concern of competition, and we're wanting to know how that's going to be engaged with. And also, one of the key things that we've found over the last couple of years is that having developmentally appropriate play-based education and then transitioning into very structured sit at your desk grade one, that's a source of concern and a source where children can experience failure coming from those two different environments. So what sort of transition between those levels of education is part of the program?
I may talk about the program, and then if you want to address some of the major policy changes that are happening in Tonga. In terms of the program, we're really trying to extend early childhood experiences to a broader majority of children. We've been very fortunate in visiting some of the Freswellian preschools, and we see that there's a lot of great quality interaction between the caregivers and the children. There's really no aim of competition in trying to build preschools and moving in that direction, but to really empower the communities and work with the communities to establish flexible activities that parents and facilitators can do, even in the very remote islands, because to increase significantly the provision of actual preschool services, it requires a different factors. It requires qualified teachers, the actual provision of the space, books, resources, training, etc. And so that has a trajectory and a rate of growth of its own. And so the kind of activity that we aim to do with the project is actually more community-based playgroups.
ECE has always been non-government. We are working towards working with them. And just recently we've established the ECE Council, which has membership of all people from major ECE providers. So therefore, they are going to work with us, and we will depend on them on what work they're doing. It's not that we're going to reinvent the wheel. We would like to work with them and engage with what they already have existing. Thank you.
So we have some interest from the Solomon Islands in the Pearl Project as well. They'd like to know how long the Pearl pilot is, if it's coming soon to Solomon Islands. And also, we'll see if Raelyn gives them a gold star first. And then how do you address within that program that transition from early childhood to primary?
Well, the way that we're working with the Pearl Project, we're really starting with a government commitment and ownership of the process. If the government really wants to do this, then we come with support and technical assistance. But it's not something that we would like to extend very rapidly to many countries, because it's a very intensive kind of work that you do with the country, with the providers, with the ministries. There's a lot of capacity building and technical assistance. This year, we're really working in both sides of the coin, the school readiness and the reading development in Tonga, but it doesn't mean that Solomon Islands could see this in the future. The project lasts for 3 years in a given country, and in addition to the full pilot program in Tonga and the the programs that we're doing on reading development in PNG, we're actually working with all of the others to try to establish when they will be ready and more committed to do the work. So it's really an issue of discussion with our clients and our counterparts.
We have another question from PNG, and this is, we have spoken a fair bit about mother tongue learning. What evidence is there to support the effectiveness of mother tongue learning? Sally?
I think Mary's
Mary. Mary Ruth?
Handball.
Very quickly, because we're almost out of time.
I think there's two answers to that. The actual brain science that becomes for a child to become a reader needs to be followed. And the evidence is that the children actually go to school, participate in school, and then their ordinary testing at school is showing incredible improvements. on a community level, teachers, assistants, parents starting to buy into the whole school experience because it's a can-do situation. And when it comes to the digital resources and ownership over literacy and my language, we're overwhelmed. The LNS projects have 100% improvement in phonemic awareness in the children we work with, 100% uptake.
Sorry, LNS. What did you say?
ALNF.
Oh, sorry, ALNF. Okay. Thought that was an acronym.
No,
another acronym.
No, it's
okay.
Just us. And so it's become a very empowering process. And the schools, children skip grades. Schools that were on the bottom of the league scale in a particular state have now received 3 times in a row the most improved school. So we don't do it in isolation. We sit beside all the other agencies that are out there, including schools and teachers and health professionals. It's safe hands around children, and parents are definitely all part of that. And then the ordinary testing shows this amazing improvement.
We have time for one last question from Sydney, and I know that you're back there.
I'm Judy Kinniston from Early Childhood Australia. We're a non-government organisation. My question was relating back to the Australian context, and I guess I'm a bit fearful and probably not as confident that we're improving, given our current climate, with an emphasis coming back very heavily on standardised testing and Myrna's comment about people being able to read but not actually comprehend. And when we start teaching to standardised testing, I think we're going to start seeing a lot more of that coming back in. And so it was really about, you know, perhaps we've got something to learn about going back to communities, and about the comment of the parents still seeing school as the formal place to learn and early childhood spaces being less informal. But I think engaging the communities is something that we can learn from some of these projects of going back, because that seems to be fairly critical, I think, particularly in work that we've done with Aboriginal communities as well.
I know that there has been some concern expressed, but I'd like each of our panellists to look at what the next big opportunity is, as you see it, in supporting early childhood education. And I might start with you, Sally, and work around.
Sure. I mean, I think the opportunity is really cross-sectoral. So, and when I mean cross-sectoral, I mean not just education, health, but also, you know, at the policy level down to community and family and to the individual child level. So, early childhood is about all what we quite often call all layers of the onion. and every layer of the onion actually has an impact on child development. So the opportunities really are being able to provide, a language of holistic child development, to bring more people around the table to have those conversations around what do we mean, a better understanding of how we improve child development in a play-based way. The science has been around for a while, but it's still relatively new and it's still getting out there, and we're still trying to work out what are the best ways of actually improving child development in the variety and diverse contexts of different cultures and countries. And that's the challenge, bringing it down to what's going to work in each community and each culture, what's appropriate for each community and culture, and what level of consultation, a high level of consultation around that.
Raelyn.
Well, for Tonga, I think it's a very good opportunity where we can stand back and look at what we have done so far and try to do it right. That I could see that with a holistic approach to the learning of the child, building awareness with everyone at every level. I think it will have to do with unlearning some people, relearning and retraining. That's all. I think that's the message that's driving home to all of us, and even us at education, we also need to know where our role starts and begin, and where we let the community empower themselves and take over the education of the child, whether it's through playgroups or formalized education. And now with just the recent, you know, approval of our Education Act, whereby compulsory education starts at 4 to 18, it has a lot of implications for us. So we're hoping that by, you know, the community being engaged and having a better understanding, it will bring a different meaning to learning altogether for us if we start early and do it right. Thank you.
Myrna.
As Sally was saying, there's a lot of research, and we keep on learning on what works and what doesn't work.
But from the things that we know that are important predictors and the skills that are important to develop, I guess that the next thing to focus, at least in the Pacific, is to get measurements, to get the data of what are the child outcomes, where are the kids in these very important domains of development. We're not the only agency working with a variety of countries. UNICEF is also working, and in fact, in the Pacific, there is a consultative work that it's now supporting countries create frameworks of how you define and analyze the project and how you establish it. And so the next thing I would say it's to get countries to get baselines and measure really where is it that you stand, in order to know how far you are from where you would like to ultimately get.
So research and understanding.
Yes, and measurement not in the sense of like testing, but yes, really understanding where you stand and where these kids are in their development domains.
Mary-Ruth, what do you see as the next big opportunity?
We're very practical. Everything that Sally and the ladies have said, but we're very practical. We're focused on that pathway to school and to becoming a reader and writer. And that's done, key takeout messages there are home language if you're a home language speaker other than English. Start early, and there is a process. There's steps that go before other steps. Secondly, it's about lots of practice and empowerment of families to provide that practice. And then it's providing really good resources and getting that curiosity and excitement going, bridging into then the formal that we're hearing before, the formal way that of doing school. And all of that has been very successful in the projects that we've been doing. So we contribute just that sliver, but it's a very important sliver for the children and their families.
And that brings us to the end of our discussion. Can you please join me in thanking our panellists, Dr. Sally Brinkman, Raelyn Lolohea Esau, Mary-Ruth Mendel, and Myrna Machuca-Sierra. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'd also like to thank everyone joining us here in Sydney or afar. Remember, you can also watch this or any of our previous Praxis discussions at wellbeing.com/Praxis. Until next time, I'm Jess Scully. Thank you for joining us.